So, Dr. Said, you are ready?
Okay, doctor.
Yeah, let's start. 3, 2, 1. Just for the people who cannot see the screen, for the participant who cannot see the screen, this 41 years old female presented with headache, station 5. Let's go, Dr. Said. 3, 2, 1, go. Let's go.
Yeah, Bismillah. Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Dr. Said, one of the doctors in the medical department. I want to confirm that Mrs. X, 45 years old.
Yes, doctor.
Yes, Mrs. X, it came to my knowledge that you have a problem of headache. Can you please give me more information about your case, please?
Well, doctor, yesterday at the night I developed this headache. Which is, I think, started just yesterday at the night. I never encountered such a headache before. And I felt like this headache is very severe. I could not stay at the home. So I came to you directly, doctor, in the ER.
Okay, this is the first time to occur to this type of headache.
Yeah, first time for me to have such a headache.
Okay, where is its place in your side of your head? This
well, doctor, it's all over my head, doctor.
All over your head.
Yeah.
Okay. This is anything increase this headache, like sneezing, coughing, leaning forward.
I didn't notice anything, doctor.
Okay. Anything relieve your pain, Mister?
No, doctor. I tried to take some tabs at my home, but it couldn't help me.
Is it increasing since yesterday or same?
It's the same, doctor.
Okay, if I asked you about the severity of the pain, as regard one is the least and 10 is the most severe.
How much I can say it is 9 or 10, doctor.
Okay, is there any variation of your headache since yesterday, during night, during day, or like?
No, doctor, it's the same.
Can you describe the character of this pain? It is dull aching or?
It is very sharp pain, doctor.
Sharp pain. Okay, is it travel to any part of your head or your neck or shoulder?
No, doctor.
Okay, it is associated with any weakness in your upper or lower limb?
No, doctor.
What about your vision? Any problem in your vision?
Well, doctor, I don't know, but I feel like my vision is become disturbed since yesterday. I start to feel sometimes when I open my eye, I feel like I see the thing is double, doctor.
The thing is double?
Yeah.
Okay, then I wanted to ask you, as regard you have any sickness or throughout?
No, doctor.
Okay, you see, as regard, can you see the size of the room?
The side on the room? Yes, doctor.
Sides of the room.
Yeah.
You can see the sides of the room. Okay. Then is there any fever since yesterday?
No, doctor.
No fever. Okay, this first time to occur this headache. Didn't occur before.
No, doctor.
Yes. You have any past history of any significant disease, Mrs. X?
Well, I have been diagnosed, doctor, with a tumor in my brain, doctor. Sorry,
tumor,
not
what type of tumor do you know?
No, they didn't tell me, doctor.
Any surgical operation for you?
No, they told me just we are going to put you under observation, doctor.
Okay. Any difference in your weight since this last
time? No, doctor. No.
Okay. Any difference in your period?
No, doctor.
Your period is okay, regular?
It's the same, doctor, yeah.
No increase in bleeding?
No.
What about your last pregnancy?
Well, I think 6 years ago. But since that time, I'm using contraceptive, doctor.
Yes. Any miscarriage?
2 minutes remain, doctor.
Okay. Then what is your concern, Mrs. X?
What do I have, doctor? What's wrong with me?
Okay. I want to ask a few more questions, then I'll answer your concern. Do you smoke?
No, I don't smoke.
What about alcohol?
I don't drink alcohol.
Okay. Any family history? You have any sister by miscarriage or?
No, my mother has died. My mother has died from brain cancer.
From brain cancer. Okay. I want to examine the patient. Any change in the hand?
No.
Any lumps and the bumps anywhere?
No.
Any cafe ole patches in the body?
No skin rash.
No skin. Any cafe ole patches?
No.
Okay. Any field of double vision, diplopia present anywhere?
Yeah, there is diplopia.
In which side?
You ask me and I will answer.
It looked to the left side?
Yeah, no diplopia.
On the right side?
No diplopia.
What about fundus examination?
Normal.
Fundus examination normal?
Yeah. And your time is finished, doctor. Examiner question, what's your diagnosis in this? What's your finding in this case?
My findings is I don't remember. I'm lost.
So what's your diagnosis and what's your differential?
My diagnosis is intracranial specific ovarian lesion.
What do you mean by intracranial specific ovarian lesion? What will explain this headache?
Tumor. Brain tumor.
Okay, how you are going to manage this patient or how you are going to investigate this patient in the beginning?
Yes. I wanted to make investigations and CBC and renal and urine, renal and the liver function.
Specific investigation.
And the imaging of the skull.
Looking for
any intracranial mass.
Okay. How you are going to treat this patient?
I treatment this patient by non-pharmacologic, by counseling and education. Mm-hmm. And multidisciplinary team, including the
specific definitive treatment,
neurosurgeon, okay. Neurosurgeon.
Okay.
So for surgery.
Okay, thank you, doctor. Your time is finished. Okay, so I'm going to comment directly in this case. This case is a case for a female, 41 years. What are the positive findings in this case? This case is 41 years old female. She had a headache, which she described it as a very severe headache, and she gave it a score of 9 or even 10 over 10.
Yes, subarachnoid hemorrhage, doctor. Sorry.
Okay. It is not subarachnoid hemorrhage. Okay. And there is one important thing, one important positive finding in the history, which is this patient is a known case of brain tumor. Another thing, this patient, she had, in addition to the headache, she had a diplopia. And if Dr. Sayed asks me more, he will find that I have one very dangerous finding, which is dizziness. Okay, dizziness from sitting to standing. This is usually because the patient if you combine all those together and try to figure what exactly the diagnosis could be, you will reach to only one possible diagnosis, which is pituitary apoplexy. Okay, this patient has sudden hemorrhage into a well-known or into previously present or into currently present, sorry, a brain or pituitary tumor. Okay, so a patient with pituitary.
But I think it should has other symptoms before, like ministerial difference.
No.
Like this.
No. By the way, pituitary apoplexy, it is very common, very, very common with the patient who have non-functioning pituitary adenoma. It is not common with the patient with prolactinoma. It's not common with the patient who have acromegaly or Cushing's syndrome. In Cushing's syndrome, the patient usually they have a microadenoma. The pituitary apoplexy, it has been reported, they are very common with the patient who have non-functioning pituitary macroadenoma. So the patient may not have any other symptoms of hypopituitarism. The issue is this tumor is going to enlarge if he developed pituitary apoplexy. In pituitary apoplexy, usually there is a hemorrhage within already present pituitary tumor. The patient will have a feature of hypopituitarism. If your case in the exam was a case similar to this case, sudden acute severe headache in a patient who is already diagnosed with brain tumor, you have to start and look for the symptoms of hypopituitarism. You ask me about the period, which is good. You have to ask me about the dizziness to rule out this patient has no defect or deficiency with the ACTH and so on, the cortisol. The third thing you have to ask about the any weight gain usually will not be present in this patient or cold intolerance because the period of the disease is very short. And the other symptoms of the hypopituitarism usually they will not be present because the duration of the symptoms is usually very short. The most common hormone that is usually affected in the pituitary apoplexy is the ACTH. This is why the patient, if you keep ask him, he will tell you, yes, I have a dizziness. I could not stand, doctor. Once I developed this headache, I felt like I am going to fall down. I can't stand. I have this dizziness associated with my headache once I try to stand from my chair or from my bed.
No visual field affection, doctor?
There is a visual field effect because usually the patient with pituitary apoplexy, they will develop third cranial nerve bulging. Oculomotor nerve will be damaged. If you ask me if I can see, if I am following your finger, when you are in the on the left outer side or the right upper outer side, I am going to tell you, yes, doctor, I can see, I see them. But you ask me just left or right. And this is not the proper way of doing the visual field. I know maybe just when you describe it to me through the Zoom, it will not be an accurate, but if you did it for a real patient, you did the visual the visual field in a proper way. The eye movement, sorry, not visual field, the eye movement. If you did it for me, if you examined me in a proper way, you will not, the patient will tell you, yes, I see double. Once you raised your hand up to the outer side in the H shape, he will tell you, yes, I have diplopia. This is indicated that the patient has a third cranial nerve bulging. Okay? The most important thing in this patient, you have to urgently admit him and you have to urgently give him a corticosteroid similar to the patient of Addison's disease, because most probably if he has a dizziness, this means that there is ACTH deficiency, which lead to cortisol deficiency. This is very important in a patient with the pituitary apoplexy, okay? Pituitary apoplexy, usually they diagnose with an MRI. You are going to do an MRI. The MRI will confirm the diagnosis very clear. And the treatment, as I told you, is just a supportive treatment. You have to check all the other pituitary hormone and to replace them if there was a deficiency. Most of the patient, they will recover spontaneously over just a few months as the blood is going to be resorbed. But if the patient has other neurological symptoms or he has a diplopia, this patient needs an urgent surgery for surgical decompression of the tumor. Okay, this is pituitary apoplexy. The other differential, you have to look for the other severe causes of the headache. Most probably, you can put subarachnoid hemorrhage. You can put also cerebral venous thrombosis as number three. Although this patient has no any other risk factor for a cerebral venous thrombosis, except one risk factor, which is the pills, which is the pills. The birth control pills can lead to cerebral venous thrombosis, but the most likely diagnosis in this case, because it has been diagnosed before with the brain tumor, will be number one is pituitary apoplexy. Okay, you forget to ask just some question. As I told you, you forget to ask about the other pituitary hormone. You didn't ask about the family history, am I right? And you did not ask about, this is all, and about the hypopituitarism symptom. Is it clear, ya Shabab? Do you want me to explain it for you?
Yes, Dr. Allah, this pituitary apoplexy, as hypocortisolism resulting in unconsciousness or loss of consciousness or altered consciousness.
This is
more prominent than the other. What is your idea?
It is not well known why pituitary apoplexy is common with the non-functioning pituitary macroadenoma, because it is something rare. It is not a case that happening every day or day. But they found that most of the cases of pituitary apoplexy, they are happening with the patient who have non-functioning pituitary macroadenoma. Okay? It can happen. Theoretically, hemorrhage into a brain tumor, it can happen. It can happen with any brain tumor. But most of the cases that reported, okay, they were reported with the patient who have non-functioning pituitary macroadenoma. This is why I try to bring for you a case, a real case, not a case that, yeah, I can bring for you, for example, a case of acromegaly or case of prolactinoma, but it is not the common. Okay, case of acromegaly or case diagnosed with prolactinoma and now present with severe acute headache, you can mention for the examiner this is pituitary apoplexy. But most probably the cases of pituitary apoplexy, they are happening with the non-functioning pituitary macroadenoma. But theoretically, yes, it can happen with the other type of brain or pituitary tumor. Okay? Is that the answer to your question, okay, Dr. Hamad?
Okay. My idea was it was that during pituitary apoplexy, because of the compressional effect of this tumor, maybe this resulted in the hypercortisolism.
The patient has not any feature of hypopituitarism. No other feature of hypopituitarism. Okay, the ACTH happened after the bleeding into the tumor.
No, this is apoplexy. Is basically bleeding into the pre-existing tumor.
Yeah,
this is the definition of apoplexy.
Yeah, this is will cause what? This will cause an expansion of the tumor.
Yes,
the collection of
yes,
the blood.
Yes, definitely.
This is after that the symptoms of hypopituitarism will arise.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
You are welcome. Okay, any question in this case?
Should this patient has another tumor, like as a part of MEN1 or MEN2?
MEN1 or MEN2, it could be, but MEN1 usually is very common with prolactinoma. Okay, usually the patient who have MEN1, they initially have prolactinoma. Although theoretically it can be, but within five minutes, very difficult to exclude those things. So for this case, you have number one to confirm the diagnosis of pituitary apoplexy. Number two, you have to rule the other symptoms of hypopituitarism because you are going to admit this patient. Okay. So theoretically, on paper, a lot of things can be invented from this case. You can bring a case of acromegaly, you can bring the case of prolactinoma, you can bring acromegaly as a part of men type 1, you can bring a prolactinoma as part of men type 1, but all that is not, is they are very rare in the reality. Pituitary apoplexy, when it was reported, usually reported with the cases of non-functioning pituitary macroadenoma. Is this the answer to your question, guys, or I'm not explaining it in a proper way?
So in this case, for examination, do I need to examine 3-4-6 nerve pulses, sir, for dilated people because patient complained for double vision, sir?
Yeah, you have to examine. Number one, you have to examine, because this patient has a diplopia, you have to ask for visual acuity and you have to ask for the eye movement. Eye movement is very important in this case because you are going to detect a third cranial nerve pulse, okay, which is very important. You can offer for the fundus. You can offer for the fundus if you want to check the papilloedema. You have to check the blood pressure because this patient, he will have blood pressure on sitting and standing because you are going to detect the postural hypotension. Okay, those are the important point in this case. Okay.
So also, I need to examine the tone power reflex also, sir.
If you have a time, but yeah, because it's a neurological case, you have to ask for the tone power and reflex. But number one, as I told you, you have to start the examination with the. If you start with the general examination, check the blood pressure on sitting and standing, examine the eye for the visual acuity and the eye movement, examine the fundus, you may find the papilloedema. Then after that, you can examine the tone and power and reflex.
Sir, if in this case, if there is no accompanying for previous brain tumor, so what other cause should I find for pituitary apoplexy?
What other causes? You can put some other differential, you mean?
Yes, other risk factor for pituitary apoplexy other than
usually it is not clear what is the cause of pituitary apoplexy. It is just a sudden hemorrhage without no apparent reason. Okay? There is nothing that have been reported with the cases with the pituitary apoplexy as a risk factor. The risk factor is the presence of already brain tumor or pituitary tumor, to be more specific. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, any question in this case, please unmute your mic and ask me so I can get your idea. So, in this case, you have to admit him, okay? You have to admit him as urgent as you can. Dr. Omar.
Shehan, for Shehan, it is a part of pituitary apoplexy.
Shehan syndrome is different. Shehan syndrome, the patient has no brain tumor. Shehan syndrome, the patient will be a normal patient, just a pregnant patient. During the delivery, she developed severe bleeding, like postpartum bleeding or intrapartum bleeding, during the delivery. Okay? During the delivery, she developed the bleeding. The bleeding, what will the bleeding cause? It will reduce the blood supply into the pituitary. Usually, if the patient is pregnant, as a part of the pregnancy, normal pregnancy, there is a slight hyperplasia of the pituitary. It is not a tumor. Physiological increase in the size of the pituitary, okay, because of the pregnancy. This will increase the demand of the blood supply into the pituitary. If the patient at the time of the delivery developed a hemorrhage or bleeding, there a necrosis will happen as a consequence to this bleeding. At that time, the patient will develop Shehan syndrome. Okay, so pituitary apoplexy is completely different from Shehan syndrome as a pathophysiology, even the presentation itself. Shehan syndrome, the patient will present with feature of hypopituitarism, like the failure to lactation, amenorrhea, fatigability, and they can develop also the dizziness. Usually the patient with pituitary apoplexy, they will have the symptom of the pressure of the tumor. This will be the main symptom or the predominant symptoms in the patient with pituitary apoplexy. They will have what? The feature of the headache, the feature of diplopia because of the pressure on the third cranial nerve. In addition to that, the patient will develop one of the symptoms of hypopituitarism and usually the low ACTH. Okay, so there is a complete difference between Shehan syndrome and between pituitary apoplexy. Is it clear, Dr. Omar, or you want me to explain it again?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr.
Welcome, Dr. Omar. Welcome. Is it clear, Shabab, pituitary apoplexy, or do you want me to?
Doctor, this pituitary apoplexy basically this is the infarction of the pituitary gland and the pituitary this is the hemorrhage and I'm talking about this Sheehan syndrome.
Sheehan syndrome, necrosis. There is necrosis.
Necrosis.
Yeah.
Necrosis. Okay.
Necrosis in the pituitary.
Necrosis due to infarction of the pituitary.
By the way, in Sheehan, there is no pituitary tube. Sheehan, there is just a physiological increase in the size of the pituitary because of the pregnancy, but there is no pituitary tube.
Yes, because of the low blood supply to the pituitary resulting in necrosis.
Yeah.
This is my.
Yeah,
and this apoplexy is the this is a basically bleeding into the pre-existing
tumor into pre-existing. Sorry, Doctor Hamad. Okay, Dr. Rana here asked a very good question. If this patient has a baseline headache, yes, it could be. Although our scenario, the patient did not have a previous headache, but it could be. I didn't mention that the patient has a previous headache. Why? Because I didn't want to waste your time in analyzing the post-headache. Because as we mentioned before, Dr. Rana, that if the patient has two headache, you have to analyze both of them. Okay, and this is going to waste your time. Usually, if the patient gave you a positive history of two type of headache, this is usually happening in station two, because you will need a time to analyze the both headache and to differentiate between them. So in this case, I ignore the part of the previous headache, although in a real scenario, the patient of course will have a previous headache because he has a pituitary tumor. So this is a very nice question, and I explain for you why. Yeah, she mentioned the adenoma by herself. Okay, any question? Any question, ya Shabab? Any question? Yeah, standard club education.
Fundus also will be okay.
Fundus, yes, of course, I told you you have to examine the fundus, you may find the feature of papilloidema. Okay?
Okay.
I hope this cleared any misconception or any confusion you may have regarding pituitary apoplexy. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the headache. If there's any question, I think this is was the last case in the headache. So I'm going. Yes, Dr. Lamis, you want to say something? Dr. Lamis? Okay, Dr. Said, you did very well. As I told you, this is not an easy case. All the case which I bring, all the case that I bring here today, they are not that easy. That I brought them today here, they are not that easy. But I'm just trying to change from the regular manner or the regular way of the cases which we already discussed here to check, to practice different cases from the which can appear in the exam. Okay, one of your colleague here asked me about the treatment. Treatment, usually this patient, if he has patient need an urgent admission, and if he has low ACTH or he has a dizziness, you have to give him cortisone, intravenous methylprednisolone. This patient has to be, or hydrocortisone, he has to be admitted. And after that, if the patient has he has a clear neurological finding, he has to be proceeded into surgical decompression of the tumor. But some cases they were reported they can recover spontaneously if the bleeding or if the body start to resolve the bleeding. Okay. Dr. Lamis, I can't hear you. If you want to say something. Okay. So Dr. Said, you did very
well. Alaykum.
Alaykum assalam, Dr. Lamis. Your connection is poor and we can't hear you very well. Sorry. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah.
I am Dr. Ramqis.
Alaykum, Dr. Ramqis. How are you?
Good? Headache. In both Chinook. Fine. Okay. Thank you. I am asking about the headache in pituitary apoplexy and Sheehan syndrome.
Sheehan syndrome, usually the presenting feature is not headache. Usually it is amenorrhea and failure of lactation in addition to the other symptoms of the hypopituitarism. They may have a dizziness, they may have and they may have other symptoms like the, like for example, the feature of hypothyroidism, okay? Like the weight gain and fatigability. But they usually they present with failure to lactation because of the low prolactin, low FSH and low LH, they will cause also amenorrhea. The main presenting symptoms usually in the patient with the Sheehan syndrome are those two symptoms. They are not usually present with the headache. I'm not sure if they can present with headache. But the usual presenting feature for Sheehan syndrome is the amenorrhea and failure of lactation, which is completely opposite to the patient with pituitary apoplexy. Patient with pituitary apoplexy present with severe acute headache.
Okay. Thank you.
You are welcome.
Thank you.
You are welcome.
Doctor, how many days usually it takes for patients with Sheehan syndrome to present? You know, can they present immediately postpartum, or
they can present immediately. But as reported, some patients, they may not know that they have Sheehan syndrome, maybe even months after the delivery. And it need, and okay. Because they may attribute their fatigue and dysmenorrhea just because of the pregnancy or post the pregnancy. So usually those cases, they are diagnosed after few months from their presentation or from the onset of the disease itself.
So usually in this patient, dizziness and postural hypotension should
they
be
may,
the one
they
that
may,
should make you...
They may, by the way, Sheehan syndrome may or may not present with other feature of hypopituitarism. The main presenting feature in them is the failure of lactation and the amenorrhea. In addition, they may develop fatigue, some weight gain. They may develop also the dizziness, or the postural hypotension.
Yeah.
This is depend on which part of the pituitary has been affected.
Necros, yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, any question, or we can explain just in a few minutes the approach for the headache. Okay, headache, usually you are going to open your station with the usual question, which we use them in every station, which is the Ferris OCD. The first, you have to ask the patient, is it the first time for you to have such a headache or not? This is going to differentiate for you between the headaches that keep coming and going, recurrent headaches, or between the first time onset of headache, okay? So the first question, is it the first time for you to have such a headache or such an attack of headache or not? The second question is the onset. Did it happen suddenly or gradually? The third question in the course, is it worsening or improving? The third, the fourth question is the duration. The fifth question, did you notice anything make it better? Like laying down or taking some medicine? And did you notice anything make it worse? And here you have to be specific and ask him about the coughing, the sneezing, and laying forward, and the morning headache. Why? Because we want to exclude the the brain tumor or anything that is going to increase the intracranial pressure. After that, you have to ask him, is it okay at a specific time or a specific place? Specific time, morning headache. Morning headache, sometimes it can be associated with obstructive sleep apnea. It can be associated with COPD. It can be associated with many things, but most importantly, we are looking for obstructive sleep apnea. Remember, morning headache is not a diagnostic for a certain disease, but it is common with the patient with obstructive sleep apnea. Is it, if it is okay at the night or at a specific time, for example, someone who is fireman, during his work, this is, can be attributed to his work. We can make, we can think about carbon monoxide poisoning. If it occurs at the evening or at his home mainly, think about carbon monoxide poisoning, which like the case we already discussed before. Then we have to ask about the site of the headache. The site of the headache can give you a clue, of course, if it is behind the eye, if it is on one side of the head, if it is on the on all over the head. Okay, migraine can be on one side of the head, JNCR arthritis can be on one side of the head, cluster headache can be behind the eye. Also, case of optic neuritis, the headache can be behind the eye. Tension headache, it will be band-like all over the head. Okay, headache of the tumor, any patient who had a tumor, usually the character of the head and the site of the head is different according to the site of the tumor itself. And the site of the tumor and the size of the tumor itself, the site and the size. So the character of the headache in a patient with the brain tumor, usually it differ according to the size of the tumor and the site of the tumor. Then after that, we have the nature or the character of the headache. It can help you to know the cause of the headache. If it was throbbing, you are going to think about the migraine. If it was pulsating, also think about migraine. If it was thunderclap headache, you have to think about the subarachnoid hemorrhage, pituitary apoplexy, and cerebral venous thrombosis. Although cerebral venous thrombosis can present with different type of headache or different character, and so on. And then you have to ask about the severity. Severity, usually we are going to ask the patient, we will going to give him a scale. We are going to tell him from 0 to 10, can you please, where 0 means there is no headache, while 10 means severe headache. Can you please rate for me or give me a score? If he told you it is 8 or 9 or 10, this is a severe headache. You have to think about, as I told you, subarachnoid hemorrhage, pituitary apoplexy, and cerebral venous thrombosis. Remember, there are other causes of thunderclap headache, but I skip them at this level because they are above the they are at a level above the basis exam. For example, there is a syndrome called reversible cerebral vasoconstriction syndrome. It's one of the causes of the severe headache, thunderclap headache, similar to a subarachnoid headache, but I think it is very rare and it is at a level above the basis exam. After we ask about the site, the severity, and we ask about the character, we have to ask the patient if this headache is going anywhere, the radiation, I mean. Then we have to exclude the migraine if this headache is preceded by any visual disturbance or by any other symptoms like smell anything or hearing anything. Okay. After that, you have to ask about the visual disturbance. If there is one question that you are going to ask it to the patient after the headache, it is the visual disturbance. And we are going to explain for you why. There are many conditions that can cause headache in addition to the visual disturbance. We are going to explore some of them later on. After that, remember, you have to ask the patient about the other CNS symptoms, including the loss of consciousness, including the seizure, including the change in the mood, including the change in the memory. You have to ask him about any weakness, about any numbness or abnormal sensation. You have to ask him about the cerebellum if he had any steadiness. You have to ask him about the extrapyramidal feature of Parkinson, which is slowness of the hand, shaking in any part of his body, and if there is any stiffness in any part of his limb. Then you have to ask about the symptoms of cranial nerve palsy, like the hearing abnormality, smell abnormality, speech abnormality, and those questions. After that, you have to ask about the general question. The general question, usually the people who are following me, we put them in two-letter abbreviation, T and LT. We are going to ask about the, especially in the CNS patient, the temperature and the trauma, in addition to the night sweat. The night sweat is a part of the general question, but in the most important two questions in the patient with the CNS, I have to ask about the trauma and I have to ask about the temperature, high body temperature. The remaining part of the T and L question is the night sweat, the loss of weight, loss of appetite, lumps and bumps in your body, and itching. Those are the general questions. After that, you have to ask about the past medical history, about the family history, about the drug history, about the social history. And remember, if your case has a visual disturbance, you have to ask about the driving. Okay, so this is the headache, analysis of the headache. There are some clue. We are going to explain it for you. How we can approach the case of headache? What are the differential for the differential diagnosis for the commonest causes of the headache that can appear in the exam? For me, I used to use an abbreviation. Just give me 1 second so I can write it for you in the screen. Abbreviation which is or mnemonic, which can help you to recall the causes of the acute or chronic or recurrent headache at the exam. There are many mnemonics out there, but this is the one which I use to practice it with my colleague when we prepared for the basis exam. Okay, so let's talk about the acute headache. Acute headache, the commonest causes in the exam, I put them in this abbreviation. Let me write it for you in the screen. Okay, is it clear on the screen, Shabab? This is the abbreviation which I use for the acute causes of headache. Okay, the G for giant cell arthritis. Okay, the G, the first cause of acute headache in the exam is the G. The G, I put it for giant cell arthritis. Then we are going to exclude the remaining letters from the great work, and we are going to focus on champs. Champs from champions. The C for cerebral venous thrombosis. Okay. The H for hypertensive urgency. The A is for acute sinusitis or acute angle closure glaucoma. The M for meningitis, the B for pituitary apoplexy, and for preeclampsia, okay? And the S is for subarachnoid hemorrhage. Okay, I can share. Okay, I'm going to clear the drawing again. I'm going to write it for you. Okay, are you following me, guys? Are you following me?
Yes, the sir.
The G for giant cell arthritis. Okay, then we are going to focus on Sean. The C is for cerebral venous thrombosis. Okay, the H is for hypertensive urgency. The A for acute glaucoma plus acute sinusitis. Okay, the M for meningitis. The B for preeclampsia plus pituitary apoplexy. Sorry, I'm so poor with my skills with the whiteboard is very poor, but I'm trying to explain my idea with just those random draw. The S for subarachnoid hemorrhage. Okay. These are the important causes for the PACES-wise at the exam level. For us at the PACES level, those are the important causes for the acute headache, and it involves and include all the cause of acute headache. Let's talk about them one by one. Giant cell arthritis, how we can suspect giant cell arthritis? Giant cell arthritis, if the patient is more than 60 years old, okay, he has, in addition to the headache, the headache itself, it will be on the lateral side of his head. He will have a visual loss. Usually it is monocular visual loss. I mean, one eye will be affected. Okay, the visual loss could be transient or it could be permanent or persistent. It could be transient or it could be resistant. The patient age will be above 60 years old. He will have other symptoms of vasculitis similar to the high body temperature, similar to the loss of the weight, similar to the night sweat. Okay, he will have also proximal muscle aching. Okay, proximal muscle aching or proximal muscle aching plus stiffness. He will have also the jaw claudication. This is giant cell arthritis. So think about giant cell arthritis if the patient was an old age, if the patient was an old age, if the patient has a headache in one side of his head, in addition he has a monocular visual loss, in addition to that the patient will have proximal muscle aching or stiffness, in addition to the jaw claudication. I think it is one of the easiest things to get it or detect it at the exam is the giant cell arthritis. Remember, giant cell arthritis also on examination, if you press on the lateral aspect of his head, you will have a tenderness. You can ask the patient a question. If you press on the side of your head, do you feel a pain? If he told you yes, it is also going with the temporal arthritis or giant cell arthritis. Let's go to the cerebral venous thrombosis. Cerebral venous thrombosis usually is one of the things that is very, one of the disease that is very difficult to be diagnosed at the exam, unless there is a very strong clue. Why? Because cerebral venous thrombosis is a triad of three things. Number one, isolated intracranial pressure symptoms of isolated intracranial pressure, like headache and diplopia. Number two, the patient will have a focal neurological deficit similar to the seizure or weakness in any part of his body in addition to the numbness. Number three, the patient may have an encephalopathy. Encephalopathy in form of coma or stupor or some degree in the disturbance of his conscious, in the level of his consciousness. So ZVT is usually a combination, cerebral venous thrombosis combination of three symptoms, you may find all the three that I had, or you may find part of them. Okay? Remember one important thing in cerebral venous thrombosis, usually the patient will give you a clue toward a thrombophilia risk factor. I don't know if you are following with me. We mentioned that the patient, the risk factor for thrombophilia, there are many risk factors. Past history of clot, family history of clot, morning discoloration of the urine, to exclude paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. The patient may have also a history of abortion to exclude antiphospholipid syndrome. The patient may have mouth sore and sore in private region to exclude Behçet disease. The patient may have a history of delivery recently or a recent history of surgery or admission. The patient may have a cancer. The patient could be a pregnant. The patient may have a nephrotic syndrome, or there was a recent history of trouble. Those are the 10 causes of thrombophilia or 10 risk factors of thrombophilia. If you have one of them, in addition to the presence of the headache, put number one but number one in your list is cerebral venous thrombosis. Okay?
Please, doctor, enumerate the
causes. Yeah, again, Dr. Hajji here mentioned very nice thing that infection in the face, like presence of cellulitis, orbital cellulitis, it can lead to also cerebral venous thrombosis. This is one of the risk factors of cerebral venous thrombosis. Again, the risk factor for thrombophilia, if your case in the exam was DVT, or pulmonary embolism, or Budd Chiari, or cerebral venous thrombosis, or was renal vein thrombosis, or retinal vein thrombosis, all those diseases, if you suspect one of them at the exam, you have to exclude all the thrombophilia risk factor, which include the family history of clot, the past history of clot, morning discoloration of urine, mouth sore or sore in private region. If the patient was female, you have to ask about recurrent abortion. You have to ask about the recent history of admission or surgery, recent history of delivery. You have to ask about the travel. You have to ask about the nephrotic syndrome. You have to ask also about, there's one last thing, I forget it. One last thing is, yeah, oral contraceptive pills. Thank you, Dr. Hajji. Okay. Cancer, yeah, Dr. Hina, thank you, the cancer, yeah. Those are the risk factors for thrombophilia. If one of them present in your case at the exam, think about the cerebral venous thrombosis. Okay, so now we have finished the giant cell arthritis. When you suspect giant cell arthritis, now we finish the cerebral venous thrombosis. Number three is hypertensive urgency. We have two types of hypertensive crisis, either urgency or emergency. The difference between them, in the hypertensive emergency, usually the patient will have an in-organ damage. I mean, he will have a renal failure, he will have a heart failure, he will have a hemorrhage into his retina, or the patient will have hypertensive urgency, high blood pressure without in-organ damage. In the both cases, usually with the urgency, the patient may have a headache, okay? Any disease can lead to hypertension. Very high blood pressure can cause headache. In addition to the headache, the patient may have other symptoms like epistaxis. By the way, hypertension with headache appears in the exam many times in the exam in a different way. There was a case of systemic sclerosis. The patient developed renal crisis. The renal crisis lead to the high blood pressure. The high blood pressure cause headache. Okay? So remember, in the exam, any disease can lead to hypertension, can cause headache, can cause acute headache. Is it clear? Okay?
This is clear.
If I am proceeding in a fast way, please stop me, okay? Number four, we have glaucoma and acute sinusitis. Both of them start with the letter A, acute angle closure glaucoma and acute sinusitis. Both of them, they are rarely or unlikely to appear in the exam, but we put them in our abbreviation just to be sure you are not going to miss them. Acute angle glossal glaucoma, usually the patient will have a headache. In addition, you will have a hallux around the light. The patient will tell you, I have a visual disturbance, there is a blurring on my vision. If you ask him how you can describe it to me, he will tell you there is a hallux around the light. The patient may have also a red eye. The patient may have also other systemic symptoms in addition to the nausea, vomiting, and some patients, they may also have an abdominal pain. Okay, this is glaucoma, acute angle closed glaucoma. Chronic glaucoma unlikely to present with headache. Okay, acute headache usually going with acute angle closed glaucoma. Acute sinusitis, it is one of the disease that unlikely to appear in the exam unless you are going to UK. Acute sinusitis, the patient will have a nasal discharge, the patient will have a fever, will have a runny nose. In addition, the site of the headache will be behind his eye, or usually in the area of the sinuses, behind his eye and the temporal aspect. This is usually the site of the headache. And usually the acute sinusitis headache happen early in the morning. Similar to what? Similar to the obstructive sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea. Is it clear before I proceed to the next one?
So then what is the cause of this headache, doctor? Sinusitis with
sinusitis.
Eye.
Yeah,
only sinusitis.
Yeah,
or part of other disease.
Sinusitis alone. Very simple case. A lot of people can miss it in the exam because it is very simple and straightforward. Similar to GERD, similar to asthma. Okay. Then we have meningitis. Meningitis, usually the patient will have acute headache. In addition to the acute headache, there is a triad for meningitis. The patient will have a neck stiffness in addition to the fever, in addition to the alternation in the level of the consciousness. In addition to that, the patient will have photophobia. Photophobia, he will tell you that I feel annoyed by the light. I feel like, did you feel like the light bothering you in the other day when you don't have a headache? If you compare it to the other day when you don't have a headache, this is the patient with meningitis. Remember the neck stiffness, remember the fever, remember the fever is very important, the headache alteration and the alternance in the level of the consciousness, in addition to the photophobia. This is can come with migraine. With meningitis. Is it clear before I proceed into the next one? Then we have preeclampsia. Preeclampsia, of course, one of the obvious things, the patient will be pregnant. She will have also lower limb edema. She will have also rapid weight gain. She may also have visual disturbance. Okay? Pituitary apoplexy, we have already discussed it by detail. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, it is very similar to the pituitary apoplexy. Both of them, they will have sudden severe acute headache. Usually in subarachnoid hemorrhage, there is the only difference or the main difference, there is no feature of hypopituitarism, but the patient may have a nausea, may have a vomiting, and may have also, the patient of subarachnoid hemorrhage may have also similar to meningitis, they may have also neck stiffness. Okay? Subarachnoid hemorrhage, one of the clue is the patient, if they bring, for example, to you in the exam, patient with other polycystic kidney disease, patient with family history of kidney disease, think about subarachnoid hemorrhage. Yeah, hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia also can be. Due to hemorrhagic telangiectasia, usually the patient will have arteriovenous malformation in the brain. They can present with subarachnoid hemorrhage, but the issue with hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia, usually most of the cases, the arteriovenous malformation in the lung. So usually they present with shortness of breath rather than the subarachnoid hemorrhage. But anyway, theoretically, it can happen. So this is all the cases of acute headache. I hope they are clear for you. This is abbreviation and how we can think about acute headache in the exam.
Very clear, Dr. Ala. But one thing in the differentials of the headache with the meningism, there okay. are subarachnoid hemorrhage and what can be differential for this?
Meningitis. Meningitis also can cause neck stiffness in addition to subarachnoid hemorrhage. But the difference, of course, subarachnoid hemorrhage, there is no fever. Photophobia is not a common feature of subarachnoid hemorrhage. Addition to that, headache itself will be in subarachnoid hemorrhage, very severe headache. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, Dr.
Yeah, I forget one important thing. Thank you, Dr. Haji. Thank you so much. It is also present in our, I don't know how I forget it. It's a cervical artery dissection or carotid artery dissection. Cervical artery dissection, we mean by them either vertebral or carotid artery dissection. One of the important things in the letter C, in the great champs, we say that the C is cerebral venous thrombosis. The other disease also start with the letter C is the cervical artery dissection. This is very important, and thank you, Dr. Haji, for remind me. Cervical artery dissection, usually the patient will have a history of trauma or hyperextension injury. Cervical artery dissection usually is very common in stage 2. If you ask the patient about his symptoms, he's going to mention for you, I developed a headache. Sometimes it is not a headache, sometimes it's a neck pain, sometimes it's a facial pain, but it can present with a headache, usually following hyperextension of his neck. The patient may be playing some form of sport where he extend his neck in a vigorous way. The patient history, which is typical history, appeared in the exam before, that the patient was in a barber shop or in a female in a beauty shop where they were sitting in the chair and they extend their neck into the back. This is one of the risky move that can develop cervical artery dissection. Remember, carotid artery dissection, it's a triad of three things: headache or neck pain or facial pain, in addition to the TIA or stroke, in addition to the Horner syndrome, partial Horner syndrome. The patient, in addition to the headache or the neck pain, he will have weakness or numbness in any part of his body, or sometimes speech disturbance. In addition to that, he will have ptosis. Okay, so this is cervical artery dissection. It's also included within the letter C. So C means either cerebral venous thrombosis or cervical or carotid. Let's be specific and mention carotid artery dissection. Okay, these are all the possible cause of acute headache that can appear in the exam. Okay. Is it clear? Hello? Is it clear?
Yes, clear. Dr. Ali.
Yes, Dr. Irene.
It's okay. Carotid artery dissection, sir, is there any symptom of neurological sign that is there any weakness, any part of the body?
Yeah, because they will have a TIA. Let me write for you in the screen. Usually, it's cervical carotid artery dissection. It's a triad of three things. Number one, the headache. But sometimes, some patients, they may not have a headache. Remember that. This is very important. They may have either neck pain or they may have facial pain. Number two, TIA or stroke. Okay, if they have TIA or stroke, they will have weakness in addition to numbness. Number three, they will have partial Horner syndrome. What do we mean by partial? They will develop ptosis only. There will be no constriction of the pupil. Okay, this is the carotid artery dissection. And this is the abbreviation for acute headache. Symbol mnemonic for acute headache. Again, it is great shams. Okay, Dr. Leila here asks, can we include the tumor within the letter T? Usually tumor, Dr. Leila, will not cause for you acute headache. They are involved in the differential of chronic headache. Okay. Yes, Dr. Hadji, the differential is either hemiplegic, because station two, Dr. Hadji, there is no clear diagnosis. We don't know what is the calibration at their sheet mark. It could be, when we discuss it, we say it could be either carotid artery dissection or it could be complicated or a hemiplegic migraine. Okay, so we mentioned at that time when we discussed that case in station two, you have three differential, either could be hemiplegic migraine, either it could be carotid artery dissection, or either it could be TIA or simple TIA, because the patient was, I think he was hypertensive if I was not mistaken. But this case discussed, I don't remember the detail, we discussed it in station. Again, one of the differential, so now, after we discuss the to make it more better and more interesting for you, I have another mnemonic for the patient with the chronic headache. What is the symbol mnemonic that we can use it to remember the chronic headache? Chronic headache. The abbreviation for chronic headache is. I'm going to write it for you here, is compost. Compost, it's a material that is used to enrich the soil before the farming. Okay, it's I don't know, بالعربي سماد. By English, I don't know any other synonym for the word compost. It's just a chemical that used to enrich the soil. Okay.
Fertilizer.
Yeah. Fertilizer for the soil. Okay. This is the meaning of compost. Okay. What are the letter for the compost? The C for carbon monoxide poisoning, which we have already discussed. So the C the C for CO poisoning. Okay, the O for obstructive sleep apnea, the M for for medication overuse headache.
Migraine?
No, medication overuse headache. Migraine, we are coming to migraine. Migraine, we put it in a different category because migraine usually causes recurrent headache. Okay. Although, by the way, okay, I don't want to delve into details. But migraine, it could be acute, it could be chronic migraine. There is a form of migraine which is chronic migraine. But for basis wise and for matter of facilitation, we don't want to jump to the level of neurologist. So I'm going to put migraine in a different category, which is the recurrent headache. Okay. The P for polycythemia. Okay. Okay, the O for the case which we already discussed, optic neuritis. Sorry, I'm not familiar with this whiteboard, so my skills today is so poor. The S for the space occupying lesion in addition to the idiopathic intracranial hypertension, plus idiopathic intracranial hypertension. Okay. The last thing is the T for tension headache. Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I missed the part of the tension. This for chronic or acute?
This is for chronic. This is for chronic, doctor.
Okay, thank you.
The S for
excuse me, doctor. Can we see P for pseudotumor cerebri? The same intracranial hemorrhage.
Yeah, it's the same. It's the same idiopathic intracranial hypertension. It's the same.
It's the tumor. P pseudotumor cerebri as a monument to help monomaniac.
The idiopathic intracranial hypertension is the same. It's the same name.
For monomaniac, doctor, for monomaniac, composed P for polycythemia and so the tumor cerebri.
Okay, it could be. You can. But usually I put both of them together, the space occupying lesion, idiopathic intracranial hypertension, because
yes.
they have the same symptoms. But you can, yes, you can put it with the B. You can put it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. One of your friend here said optic neuritis is chronic. Optic neuritis usually it is not chronic. Usually it is something in between the post, in between the acute and chronic. But the symptom will not be over days. Usually it will be over weeks. This is why I prefer to put it within the chronic cause. Okay. I don't know the name of the doctor which asked this very nice question, a great question. Is optic neuritis a chronic? We already discussed optic neuritis. And if you remember, the duration of the attack was 8 days. Okay? Usually, it's in weeks. Optic neuritis, the headache, usually the patient will have it for weeks. So I prefer to put it like in between subacute. Yeah, we can say subacute, but unfortunately, we don't have a classification or category to call it subacute. And for matter of facilitation, better to use just the acute and chronic classification. What is the other O? The O, one of them for obstructive sleep apnea, the other one for optic neuritis. Okay. Because all of those type of chronic headache, by the way, they can present for weeks. For example, CO poisoning can present within a weeks. Obstructive sleep apnea, the patient can present to you within weeks. Medication overuse headache, it's a chronic. Polycythemia usually also can weeks or months. Optic neuritis usually within the patient within weeks. Space occupying lesion and idiopathic intracranial hypertension, both of them can be weeks or months. Tension headache also can be weeks or months. Okay, how we can detect every one of them? Usually CO poisoning, we have discussed it by detail, so I'm going to skip it. Obstructive sleep apnea, the patient will be obese. Usually there will be a clear underlining risk factor for obstructive sleep apnea. Usually it's a morning headache. If the patient told you, yes, I have a morning headache, ask him about the excessive snoring at the night while he is sleeping and tendency to sleep while he is driving or while he is reading or while he is watching TV. Those are the screening questions for the obstructive sleep apnea. And usually the patient will have an underlying cause for weight gain, like the patient could be a hypothyroidism, the patient could be a diabetic patient, the patient could have an acromegaly, the patient could have polycystic ovary syndrome, and so on. Those are the symptoms of or the screening question for the obstructive sleep apnea and how we can detect it from the history. Medication overuse, usually the patient will have an underlying primary headache, like he may have a tension headache or he may have a migraine for a long period. And he is taking analgesia either for 3 months or taking analgesia, sorry, for 10 days or for 15 days per month for more than 3 months. This is will diagnose medication overuse headache, and it's a very common case in station two. The patient will have two different headache. Primary headache, which is old headache, like the patient will give you a history of migraine. And when you analyze the first headache, you will find a typical feature of migraine. Then this patient suddenly develop a different type of headache, which is the new headache, the headache of the medication overuse, okay? Polycythemia, usually the patient will have either, he will be a heavy smoker, the patient will be a heavy smoker, all the patient will have underlining COPD, all the patient will have polycythemia or gravura, all the patient will have also renal cell carcinoma, okay? This is for polycythemia. Polycythemia appeared in the in that 3 2019. The patient with headache, he have polycythemia because he was a smoker, heavy smoker, and he has underlying COPD. Optic neuritis, we have already discussed it. Space occupying region, you have to screen it by ask the patient, as we said in the headache, you have to ask the patient if this headache increase by bending forward, by coughing, by sneezing, if it associated with any morning sickness. Idiopathic intracranial hypertension, usually the patient will be an obese patient. The patient will also have a form of diplopia or six cranial nerve palsy. The patient will have also papilloedema. And usually the patient will be obese and he may taking other, he may take medication like patient taking steroid or taking oral contraceptive pills or taking some retinoid. All those are risk factor for idiopathic intracranial hypertension. And doxycycline, yeah, it's also one of the risk factor. Tension headache, usually it's a diagnosis of exclusion. You have to ask the patient about steroid, yes, steroid also we mentioned it, one of the risk factor. Tension headache, usually it is a diagnosis of exclusion. You are going to get it after exclude everything and ask the patient about his mood and ask the patient. Sometimes the patient may also have underlying irritable bowel syndrome, or he will have other form of stress disorder like fibromyalgia. If the patient has underlying fibromyalgia or the patient has underlying irritable bowel syndrome, and he has stress within his life, within his home, with his family, or at his job, you have to think about tension headache. Tension headache, usually the head in a form, it is usually mild or moderate headache. And the headache usually, it's a band-like headache. And those patients, if you examine them, you press the muscle in the face or in the head or in the skull, the patient will have a tenderness. Pericranial muscle, like the area at the scalp, the temporal aspect, if you press them, the patient will have tenderness. Okay? This is the causes of chronic headache. By the way, this is basis-wise. There are many other causes of...
Tender and tension headache, doctor?
Yeah, tender, very, very, very cranial muscles. They will have a tenderness. If you examine the patient and you press over the scalp, or you press over the temporal aspect, the patient will have a tenderness. This is one of the positive finding in the patient with a tenderness, with attention headache. Okay? So those are the causes of the tension, of the chronic headache basis wise. Remember, as one of your colleague mentioned, there is an area between the acute and between the chronic. It involves a lot of the differential. From those causes, the causes of the chronic headache, which one of them usually associate with a visual disturbance? Which one of them? Usually the spastic cubaing lesion and idiopathic intracranial hypertension, they can cause visual disturbance, and optic neuritis. Those are the two causes that can lead to visual disturbance. A spastic cubaing lesion, if the lesion, for example, compressing one of the cranial nerve, it can lead to visual disturbance. The idiopathic intracranial hypertension, usually those patients have diplopia because they have 6 cranial nerve palsy, and they will also have papillo edema. Patients with papillo edema, whether from a spastic cubaing lesion or idiopathic intracranial hypertension, they will have transient visual loss. Okay, then we have optic neuritis, as we discussed it before, it can cause visual disturbance. Then, any question in the causes of the chronic headache?
No, sir.
Temporal arteritis, this is in acute. Dr. Nafisa, the causes of acute headache that can cause, by the way, most of the causes of the acute headache can cause visual disturbance. If we will recall them again, just let me clear the screen. Okay, I'm going to go back just to the acute headache to remind you which one of them that can cause the visual disturbance. Remember, we mentioned they are great champs. Okay, the G for Janssen arthritis, it can cause visual disturbance. The C for cerebral venous thrombosis and carotid artery dissection. Carotid artery dissection usually does not cause visual disturbance in a clear way. It can cause ptosis, and if the patient has TIA or stroke, he can have visual disturbance, but this is not common in the exam, so we are going to ignore it. Cerebral venous thrombosis, it can cause visual disturbance also. The A for acute angle closure glaucoma and acute sinusitis. Acute closure glaucoma, it can cause visual disturbance. The M for meningitis, it can cause photophobia and visual disturbance. Okay. The P for preeclampsia and for the P was pituitary apoplexy and preeclampsia. Both of them, they can cause visual disturbance. The last thing is the S for subarachnoid hemorrhage. Subarachnoid hemorrhage can cause visual disturbance if it affects the third cranial nerve palsy or one of the cranial nerve palsy. In some time, it can cause diplopia. So it can or it cannot. Okay? Subarachnoid hemorrhage also can cause visual disturbance or can cause diplopia. Very clear, the symptoms of pituitary apoplexy and subarachnoid hemorrhage, they are very close, except just the the feature of hypopituitarism, you are going to find it with the pituitary apoplexy. You are not going to find them with the subarachnoid hemorrhage. The last thing in the headache is the cause of recurrent headache. Causes of recurrent headache, they are very clear. They are very simple. They are just migraine, cluster headache, or tension headache. Tension headache can be chronic, can came in attack. The last thing is pheochromocytoma. Okay, migraine can cause headache with visual disturbance. Cluster headache can cause headache with visual disturbance. Pheochromocytoma unlikely to cause headache with visual disturbance. Unlikely. Remember, pheochromocytoma is a triad of three things: attacks of headache plus palpitation plus sweating. Sorry. Sweating. Okay. Okay, Shabab. In addition to other symptoms like the tremor, diarrhea, all those symptoms can happen with pheochromocytoma, but the triad of pheochromocytoma is the headache, sweating, and palpitation. Trigeminal neuralgia. Trigeminal neuralgia mainly cause facial pain rather than headache. Facial pain, it is not a headache, doctor. So this is my abbreviation or my mnemonic, which I use to prepare for the basis. If you have other mnemonic, if you think you have an easiest way to approach your case, it is good. Use what you think that will help you to pass the exam. Use the thing that suit you. And at the end, the final goal is to pass the exam and to pass the basis. I hope that was helpful for you. I hope you find it clear for you.
So this tension headache is also intermittent headache?
Yeah, tension headache, by the way, it can cause intermittent headache and came in attack. The attack of tension headache, it can persist from up to, let me remember, because it can persist up to 72 hours from 5 hours or 6 hours up to 72 hours. It can come and go in attack. Okay, so tension headache, we add it in the boss form of the headache, whether it is chronic or it is recurrent. It can come more than 10 episodes, 10 or more episodes, occurring in less than 1 day per month. Okay, or it can be chronic more than 15 days per month for more than 3 months. This is, we call it the chronic tension headache. Okay, so it could be episodic or it could be chronic headache.
Dr. Alam, this yes. Medication overuse headache, it can come all the chronic headaches, or what are the combination it is coming? Any patient is already using medication for one type of headache, most probably chronic. What are the combination it is coming with?
What other? Sorry, I didn't get your question. What other?
This chronic headache is coming, as you told, that the patient is having tension headache, he is using the medicine, and now he has to have the medication overuse headache. Yeah. What in all chronic headaches it can come as a medication overuse headache, or what other combination of
headaches is coming? Medication overuse headache is something precipitated by the chronic use of analgesia. If you are using, let's say you have a headache, yes, and you are taking analgesia like paracetamol more than 15 days per month for more than 3 months. Okay, yes. This can lead to medication overuse headache. Or if you are using analgesia with combination medication, any combination analgesia for more than 10 days per month for more than 3 months, it can lead to medication overuse headache. Usually, the patient who are taking this medicine, they are taking it because they have an underlying headache. The patient will have a migraine, but he is overusing the analgesia. This is why he will develop a new type of headache, different character. It will be totally different from the character of the migraine. The patient in the exam will give you a history of migraine, unilateral throbbing headache with fear of exposure to the light, okay? Coming attack, this is migraine. Then he starts to use analgesia. The issue is he's overusing this analgesia. The new headache the new headache will be different than the character of the different from the character of the from the different from the character of the of the of the previous headache. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
I mean, the frequency of the headache will be more and more, and the frequency of the new headache will be more and more. The location and the type of the headache, it will be different. It will not be throbbing or pulsating. It will be dull aching, for example. It will be all over his head. Okay? So you will find that there is a clear variation between the old headache and the new headache.
Okay, thank you, doctor. Actually, I was asking the scenarios which have come in the exams, your experience. What are the combination mostly they are asking?
Migraine. The patient has primary migraine. This is an old scenario. It appeared in date 1, 2019. And also, it is frequent and repetitive scenario, but it did not appear recently. It appeared, I think, in date 1, 2019.
Thank you, doctor.
You are welcome. You are welcome. One of your colleagues asked here, what is the treatment of the medication overuse headache? Medication overuse headache, usually the treatment, there is a debate about the proper way, but the proper way of treatment or the recommended way is the discontinuation of the medicine. But they said if the patient is taking some form of complex analgesia, like for example, he's taking benzodiazepine, or he's taking barbiturate, or he's taking opioid, better to be withdraw it in a gradual way. Okay. So if the patient is just taking simple analgesia, you have to stop the medicine, immediate discontinuation of the treatment. But if the patient is taking some form of complex treatment, usually, or this is something debatable, by the way, it is not something. There is no clear evidence between the abrupt versus the tapered discontinuation. Okay, abrupt discontinuation is usually the preferred way, but there are some also advice on the tapered discontinuation if the patient is taking some complex form of analgesia like the barbiturate or benzodiazepine, or he's taking opioid.
Dr. Ala, paracetamol, 15 days per month for 3 months.
Yeah, 15 days per month for more than 3 months. If it is...
What about the other?
If it is some form of... if it is combination analgesia, you have to take... the patient should take it more than 10 days is enough to diagnose the patient with medication overuse headache.
For 3 months also?
Yeah, for 3 months, most of them.
Oh, thank you.
Welcome. More than 10 days, yes, Dr. Haji, more than 10 days per month for more than 3 months. Yes.
What kind of visual disturbance for each kind of headache? I mean, he may tell blurring of vision.
Okay, visual disturbance, I'm going to, inshallah, if I have a time, I'm going to leave it for another session, because the analysis for visual disturbance, although it is closely connected and it is closely related to the headache, I am going to leave it to another session, because it contains a lot of detail. There is a differential for red eye, there is a differential for complete loss of vision, transient loss of vision, differential for discharge from eye, differential for diplopia, differential for ptosis, and it's going to take a little bit more time, so I prefer to leave it for a different session or a separate session.
Okay.
So if there is any question, or we can stop here.
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Ara.
Alaikum salam, Dr.
I'm aware about the updates concerning the recordings, but I can see the recording button. So, is there any intention of sharing the recordings?
Wallahi, actually, yani honestly, to be honest with you, as I told you, this recording, they are putting me in very difficult position. I don't want to leave any evidence against me because, as mentioned, as has been, I already shared it in the group, that sharing the material related to the basis or telling that, okay, practice, there is no issue with practice, but the issue is, when I say this case appeared in UK, this case appeared in the last day, and this case appeared in the 2019, this is where I'm putting myself in a risk. So this is why I don't like to, this is what made me change my mind from regarding the sharing the session. And one of my colleague is a tutor. He received a clear warning. I don't want to mention his name, but he received a clear warning from the Royal College because he was using the same, he was teaching in the same way we are teaching. So I'm sorry for that. But if you want me to repeat, anything at any time, I am okay with that. And I'm now, as you can see, I am using the whiteboard. I'm trying to compensate the recording with other things.
No, thank you. It's just about like the time, because you know, like we are not always available when you are available. So yeah, it was.
We can repeat it. No issue. We can repeat the session again if you want.
No worries. Okay. Yeah, thank you so much. Anyways, yeah, it's understood. Yeah, we don't want to risk your position. Thank you.
Okay, I'm so sorry, and thank you all of you for understanding this point.
Thank you. Jazakallah khair.
Dr. Ala, do you have your WhatsApp group or something like that?
Yeah, we have our WhatsApp group. I think I shared it at the beginning of the session, but let me share it with you again. If this...
Thank you.
Okay, welcome. Okay, any question, guys? By the way, as I told you...
Yes, Dr. Ala, sorry, one question from my side.
Yes.
Mashallah, you have delivered very good lectures and all these things. We are very thankful to you. Only one question I want to ask, that if station 5 we reach to the diagnosis early, like within 2 to 3 minutes,
okay.
So does it necessary we have to be exclude out the other differential diagnosis?
It is not necessary, but you have to go through all the point within the history. I mean, don't forget to ask about the drug history, the social history, the family history. Those things, they are very important in the exam. So even if you got the right diagnosis, and if, by the way, the family history was not relevant to your case and you did not ask about it, you are going to lose mark in the exam. Even if the family history is negative, the social history was negative, the drug history was completely negative, and you did not ask about that, you are going to lose a mark. And this is, by the way, happened to one of my colleagues. His case was medication. It was metformin-induced diarrhea. Just a patient who had been diagnosed with diabetes and recently developed diarrhea, he's taking metformin. He got the diagnosis. He ignored the other part of the history, like the family history. And the examiner deducted from him a mark because he did not ask about the family history, although family history is not relevant to the case.
Oh, right.
Okay.
So this case came in the station 5, metformin related diarrhea.
Yeah, metformin. And we already, I think, practiced this case before. So remember to ask all the other part, important part of the history. Even if the differential you have already excluded, it's important to ask about the other part of the history. And it's also important to examine the patient.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank
you. You are welcome, doctor. So if there is no question, yeah.
In my exam, I had migraine, mm-hmm. With a typical feature with photophobia, but changed the nature of headache. The patient developed changing or different type of headache.
Mm-hmm.
So excluding meningitis and other causes of photophobia, but the examiner, when asking me about investigation, when I told him CT scan, he was like angry and he doesn't want to investigate such a patient.
Okay, there are criteria they are criteria for requesting requesting an MRI or any image for the patient with a headache. Okay, photophobia is not one of them to suspect that the patient has to request an MRI for the headache. If the patient has meningitis, for example, I'm expecting meningitis, I'm going to do first with the basic investigation, then I'm going to ask for a lumbar puncture. Imaging is not a priority
I
here.
Ask for the lumbar puncture.
Okay.
I ask for
okay. The examiner was angry because I think the calibration was migraine, was just a migraine. And we in patient with migraine, we don't routinely ask for imaging. Unless the patient has focal neurological deficit, the patient has headache awakening from the sleep at the night, the patient has loss of consciousness, the patient has fever, headache with red flag, like headache increase with coughing or bending or sneezing. Those are the criteria for new onset headache in a patient more than 50 years old. This is also one of the criteria or indication for the headache. Migraine is diagnosed by clinical diagnosis. So if you ask for image to the patient with migraine, the examiner may get a little bit angry. I don't know honestly what was the your case or what was the detail or why the examiner was angry. But even if you think about meningitis, no need to mention imaging in your or in the beginning of your investigation list. Okay. So I think most probably your case was just a migraine, and this is why the examiner got angry. This is my, I don't know, this is my explanation for situation, but I'm not sure exactly why the examiner was angry from you.
Yes, he need to, from me to reassure the patient like that.
Reassure him, and there is no need for the imaging.
Imaging. Mm. Okay, thank you, Dr. Ala.
You are welcome. Okay, again, yes, Dr. Tanzil, you want to say something? Okay, if there is no question, we are going to stop here. And because headache is closely related to the visual disturbance, next session, inshallah, maybe within 2 days or 3 days maximum from today, it is going to be about visual disturbance. Because it is very, very closely related to the headache, and there are a lot of cases where there is there the patient will have a visual disturbance and he will have a headache. We are going to discuss the approach for visual disturbance by detail later on in other session. Just before we leave, I would like from you, if it is okay with you and you are not busy right now, I'm going to send for you at the group a link for a survey, similar to survey which we filled in the last session. It's not going to take from you just a 2 minute, maximum 2 minutes. So please, if you have a time, fill the survey for me, and I will be very grateful for all of your feedback.
Sure, thank you so much.
You are welcome, everyone.
Okay, sir, okay, we will send it, inshallah.
Okay, and I'm going to share with you, inshallah, the time for the next meeting, inshallah, later on.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Welcome. You are welcome.
Thank you very much, sir.
You are welcome.
Thank you very much.
You are welcome.